Hello, we're in Washington, D.C. at SelectUSA at the wonderful Gaylord National Convention Center. I'm here with the Assistant Secretary for Commerce for Global Markets. Thank you for joining us. I wonder if we could begin by just giving your general impressions of the event. We've had big announcements in the semiconductor sector. What are your thoughts on the final day?
All I can say is wow. This has been a spectacular event. The numbers speak for themselves in terms of the largest number of registrants we've had, the largest number of companies we've ever had show up, the announcements that we've made, including, of course, the historically significant announcement by GlobalWafers. But the numbers, I think, actually don't capture what we really all felt for 3 days. The energy was palpable, the eagerness to get together and get deals done and get deals done soon was very real. And so for all of the numbers, I think what we're going to see coming out of this summit over the course of the next year is that those numbers are going to be completely surpassed by just by virtue of the energy that we saw here this past few days.
Certainly that GlobalWafers announcement was significant. Of course, there's been a lot of efforts to try and develop the domestic supply chain within the semiconductor sector. I wonder if you can reflect a little bit on that, because a lot of the discussions I've had have been around actually the issues of the supply chain, but the US government, of course, is focused on that domestic capacity building. What would you say is the current progress and what more needs to be done?
So, you know, Alex, when I refer to the GlobalWafers announcement as historic, that was no exaggeration. It's historic because it literally plugs the most significant hole in our domestic supply chain when it comes to semiconductors. By virtue of GlobalWafers' $5 billion plus investment in Texas, they are plugging that hole in silicon wafers, and it was a significant gap in our supply chain. As you know, we've had disruptions in the supply chain because of the pandemic, and has really revealed vulnerabilities in a number of supply chains, but particularly with respect to semiconductors. The ability to plug that hole with GlobalWafers has overnight will produce a resilience in our semiconductor industry, which is going to be transformative in our economy for generations to come. In fact, right now, we are in a situation where if we were to shut off imports of silicon wafers, we would have to shut down semiconductor production in weeks. But in fact, because of this, we now know that GlobalWafers intends to produce more than enough silicon wafers to match our semiconductor needs for years to come.
At the same time, while we're speaking, the US CHIPS Act has not quite passed Congress. They're still fleshing out the details. It's quite interesting that we have these large announcements from foreign investors, but there is still not the guarantee that this legislation is passed. Can you reflect a little bit on that?
Sure. You know, I think what we're seeing is a real demonstration in faith and in the confidence of the U.S. economy and where it's going for the long term, and frankly, a faith that Congress will do what we know that Congress recognizes it should do, which is to pass the CHIPS Act. I think these companies share our belief that Congress will take the necessary action in the coming weeks so that they can make the investments that they need to make. I think GlobalWafers and other companies have been clear that their significant announcements that they've made really are contingent on the ability to get that bill passed and get that funding out the door. And we look forward to working with Congress to get that done.
My final question is a topic that's come up again and again with my discussion with investors, site selection consultants, and economic development organizations over these last couple of days. And that is both land and labor constraints. You've got massive shortages of labor in many different industries, and existing companies and locations are often finding it difficult to fill factory floors. At the same time, the US is attracting more FDI, and there's more new factory floors to be filling. What's your impressions of that? It seems to me as if the US's capacity to actually attract more FDI may be limited at this current moment in time.
Well, Alex, I'm proud to say that actually the facts belie that. What we are seeing is not a restriction in the FDI coming in for fear of such shortages, but in fact, a recognition that the U.S. workforce and the other assets that the U.S. brings are precisely why there's more FDI than ever coming into the United States. As you know, this is the 10th year in a row that the U.S. has been designated the most popular FDI destination by A.T. Kearney, and I think that alone speaks for itself, because what that shows is that our ability to sustain that investment pre-pandemic has continued through the pandemic and now will sustain us afterwards. Certainly there are challenges with labor shortages across sectors. We see that around the world. That's certainly not unique to the United States. I think here we're taking a number of steps to really try to respond to that. We're working with industry and with universities to try to plug some of those gaps in certain labor markets. We are working with unions as well to support their training and other activities to really beef up the workforce in a number of sectors where we've lost a generation of workers that have retired during the pandemic. So we're taking concrete actions to address those shortages, but I think what you're seeing is foreign companies recognizing that those labor shortages are not endemic or and are more a blip and that we will return to a period of consistent, strong workforce development.
Could immigration be an answer? I mean, also that's a discussion that's come up that, you know, if perhaps the process of getting a work visa was quicker or that you could fill those roles with foreign nationals, then that might be one solution.
Yeah, I think immigration is part of the answer, but that's already the case. I don't think that's something new for us. As you know, we have a sophisticated visa regime that recognizes companies that have needs for workers, and we're working to ensure the full effective implementation of that visa regime to meet those the needs of industry in a manner that's consistent with our national and security interests.
Well, Assistant Secretary, thank you very much for taking the time.
Thank you, Alex. It's been a pleasure.